ladies and gentlemen. Dear Apostle, thank you very much for the opportunity that we have, and all the SAFETY4SEA team. A strategic approach to key trends and challenges for the future of shipping. What I will try to do during my short presentation, I will try to give our views, my views on what we have in the next, in view of 2030 and 2050. I'm not going to discuss anymore about 2020, as I believe it's 2020 already yesterday. So, there are a number of global shifts reshaping the maritime world and the industry, which has already started innovating in order to meet them. But how the shipping looks like in 2030 or even 2050? Which are the implications for the ship owners, the ship managers, right now, but also for the future? This is what I'm going to analyze. I'm going to present to you the geo-economical and commercial outlook, very briefly, the new technologies, operational efficiencies, and what we are calling in our days high reliability organizations. Regarding the geo-economical outlook and shipping trades and partners, our industry, shipping industry, had been hard hit by several geopolitical obstacles. All of us were aware about the trade war between the United States and China in our days. Earlier this summer, in July, we had these attacks and Hormuz Straits and all these changes that we have. Trade cannot be seen in isolation from the wider geopolitical developments, since geopolitical conflicts often spill over directly or indirectly into the flows. There's a lot of messages, a lot of discussions in several shipping fora. The key message of all these discussions is that the maritime industry, our industry, can and must play an active role in shaping the future of the trade, since it cannot be expected that governments alone can manage the situation. You can see that what is in front of us is already here, 21st century, Silk Road map for a belt of overland corridors and maritime road of shipping lanes is expanding in scope. We have the, as long as the ice melts, we have new routes open to sail out of the Arctic cycle, navigation along the Northern Sea route, the NSR, which will be possible the year round in the years to come as the climate change, as the climate continues to warm. On the other hand, we have the regulatory, the new technologies and innovation. Technology on board vessels is aiming towards simplifying processes, but also driving efficiencies. We are moving, our industry is moving ahead in towards a digitalized, data-driven world, with the challenge being to find the right long-term technologies and link terrestrial location with vessels at sea in an efficient way. Industries across the spectrum are coming to terms with the fundamental changes, the technological advances in areas such as artificial intelligence, AI, robotics, automation, and connected devices will have the opportunities and threats that they pose. Our industry faces a tipping point where the technological developments such as autonomous and smart ships are turning the realms of science fiction into hard fact. All of us were aware the terms smart shipping, autonomous vessels, they are quite very often discussed in several agendas. The transformation will invite a cycle of regulatory and legal change. Regulators will have to rewrite the rules that have governed how vessels can and should operate safely, efficiently, but also remotely. Of course, these changes will not happen overnight. It will challenge traditional business models, and companies have to adapt in order to be able to survive and to and prosper. At the same time, creating a culture of innovation is not an easy task. Organizational innovation means new organizational methods, changes in business practices, changes in management strategy, customization, regular, and other cyclical changes, mergers and acquisition. But what about the regulatory framework and the decarbonization of shipping, which is again very high on our agenda? In April 2018, IMO adopted an initial climate change strategy under which international shipping must reduce the greenhouse gas emissions by at least 50% by 2050. The IMO identifies four major pathways towards emission reduction, namely improvements in energy efficiency, renewable sources of energy, fuels with lower carbon content, and of course, technologies to remove emission released during operation. If this is the goal, this is our target as a shipping industry to be delivered on IMO 2050, all pathways are likely to play a part in the future of the shipping. Decarbonization. It is to this challenge in water that an in-depth analysis on decarbonization is crucial. Why? Improving the energy efficiency of vessels and deciding on which strategy we have to adapt in order to reduce the greenhouse gases are two very important initial steps on path towards decarbonization. Conversation of the adoption of energy management solutions centered around three key themes: reliability of technology, regulatory constraints, and of course, the cost. Priority for the most operators is to ensure that they stay up to date, for sure, comply with the rules and regulations, and they come in environmental, current and incoming environmental rules. Definitely, decarbonization is the number one challenge that we have to deal with as an industry, sitting three key elements to accelerate pace. Shipping industry has to get, we need to have efficiencies higher than we have today and roll out all the efficiency technologies that we are able to put in play. We have to work on logistics in getting the chains optimized, including port and not only ships. And third, and most importantly, shipping industry has to work on carbon neutral fuels. We heard a lot of things about LNG fuels, what we're going to do, how we're going to adopt. Again, to fully understand what it will take to adopt alternative fuels globally, we can compare, as an example, the LNG as a fuel. In certain circumstances, solutions aim to at mitigating one type of pollution, which may cause other problems. For example, improving the combustion efficiency of ship's engines to reduce carbon dioxide can result in increasing on NOx emissions. Digitalization. When we are referring to digitalization, it's meaning that we are an ongoing improvement and transformation of business operations, functions, models, and processes leading to a more efficient exchange of information within and among companies, vessels, adapting this transformation. Digital technology can be a significant enabler of growth and innovation. The maritime industry is looking for ways to apply new digital technologies to conventional and new business models and making headlines with announcements of maritime companies partnering up to tech firms. High reliability organizations. The high reliability organizations and lead theory were developed as a conclusion that accidents are inevitable in some systems organizations due to their characteristics. HROs, as are known, recognizes that the world is a complex, unstable, unknowable, and unpredictable. the HRO's perspective maintain reluctance to the simplification to the traditional risk assessment. The main attention of the HROs is given to the real work going on the front line of operations. By empowering those doing the actual work, operators have the possibility to solve the situations themselves based on their own experience and knowledge. This is in contrast to traditional safety management as we know up to now, from the era of human factors with a focus on the control of human behavior. It is acknowledged that higher reliability is depending on how things are done on daily work and is a result of good teamwork and cooperation. If somebody fails, it's seen as an opportunity to learn both for the crew and the shore management. Everybody is constantly trying to improve reliability, applying high flexibility and encouragement to critical views. Pardon. In order to conclude, as we have 1 minute, I don't want to stop immediately. The transition to a low carbon and clear emission future is challenging. The industry has to find solutions that are at once commercial viable, technically feasible, and safe. Since we are shipping this, we are in efficient mode of transportation, a significant reduction in fuel consumption. We have been achieved recently improvements in design and operation, and it would be difficult to find further meaningful greenhouse gases related gains solely by using current technologies. The challenge ahead, if we are looking to the future, the industry contributes to climate change, although small, it commands growing scrutiny. Industry needs to increase the preparedness for climate change risk and needed to understand the risk awareness and how we can deal with the new regulations. Thank you very much.